Good morning. Welcome this morning. Just want to go over a couple of announcements that are in the bulletin. If you can just look through, there's some dates for Women's Fellowship we want to highlight. I know Lindsay, you have an announcement. Lindsay's going to come on up.
The Christian Ed Committee is looking for donations of candy to stuff in the plastic Easter eggs for the Easter egg hunt that is April 8th. We'd like the donations here by March 26th so that the youth can stuff them the following week at their youth meeting. Any questions, see somebody on the Christian Ed Committee.
Also, just want to remind everyone that the Dominican trip is having a fundraiser this coming Saturday, March 18th, at the Richland Fire Hall. Our own Ricky, who is not here today, his band, The Rockets, will be performing at the Fire Hall. There is a $2 cover charge. Ricky plays 50s and 60s music, so it's sure to be a good time. I've seen them play already, and they're pretty awesome. And also, our men's quartet will be opening that night, so hopefully you can come out and support the trip. Krista, you have an announcement, too.
I just wanted to give a little bit of an update on our trip, because we got some information from the community, directly from the community this week, that we're excited and a little bit nervous about all at the same time. While we were planning to do the food distribution, and we will continue to plan to do the food distribution, the one thing that the pastor has called for or asked for in the community when one of our leaders has gone down into the community this year, he was with us last year and will be with us this year, is for us to start another major building project, and that is a kitchen. I don't know if you remember or seeing pictures of the kitchen that is currently on the church. It is a little tiny shack which has a few propane burners with two little tiny like grill type things on top, and that's actually how they cook all of our meals when we're there. We've talked about this and how great food is a need in this community, and the reason that the pastor has asked for us to start a kitchen on their church is because food is such a need in this community. So he is looking that if he gets a kitchen on his church, that not only when we come in once a year and do food distribution, but that he might be able to reach his community throughout the year and be more, it might be more sustainable throughout the year, that he can have community outreach with food and programs like that for his community. So he has asked us to, if our group would be willing to start another major building project in their community. My heart, of course, says yes. So if you guys would just continue to pray for our team and that we might be able to raise some extra funds to be able to start that project, because it's going to be another big project. Probably, obviously, will not be done this summer. This is probably going to take a year or two to do and get up and running, but our hearts say that that's something that we should definitely do. And also, something else that was huge for our family this week was, for the past year and a half, my family personally has been trying to bring home two of the kids that we met on our very first trip to the Dominican Republic. And this week, they got approved for their visas. So that was really huge for us. And I hope you will pray for them as they continue to go through the process and they will get their visas. And this summer, when we bring them home, they will be here for about 3 weeks. I hope you will all welcome them into our church, because they are super excited to meet our church family and our family here. So we are really excited about bringing them home. So that's all. Just keep us all in prayer as we get through the next couple months till we get there. And yeah, thank you all for your support.
Okay, and I just wanted to say one more thing, that Marty and Rachel did get home safely. I'm sure most of you have assumed that, or I know Rachel's been becoming friends with people on Facebook, so I'm sure people have seen that as well. But let's continue to pray for them as they go about the process of leaving their church. They still need prayer for housing. So if you can continue to keep them in prayer for that. And also, as we start to transition them in, be prayerful about what your role in their transition could be. You might be approached by somebody on the transition team to help with that. We're looking at an installation service of June 25th, and that's basically where they transfer their membership. He will be preaching before then, but that will be the official installation. So continue to pray for them. And now we are going to hear from the Cherub Choir. Matthew, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So the praise team will come up, and then please rise and sing with us. We're going to actually do Come As You Are first, and then Open the Eyes of My Heart. So there's a little switch in your bulletin. So please stand and sing with us.
Your mercy.
Lord, we just thank you so much for this day, and we thank you, Lord, that we can be gathered together to sing praises to you, to worship you, to hear your word, to just be in fellowship with one another. Lord, we just pray that you would open our eyes so that we can see you, open our hearts that we can take in your word, that we can let it change our lives, Lord. And we just pray that we would be united in our mission to serve you, to tell the world about you, to be your light. We just thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in this church and will continue to do. And we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, would the ushers please come forward? And would you pray with me? Lord, again, we just give you all the praise and glory for all that you've done for us. We just thank you, Lord, for all of the ways you've provided for us. And we just pray as we give a portion of that back to you, Lord, that you would bless it, that it would go forth through our church and into the world, and just that people would be blessed and that you would be praised. And we just pray, Lord, for your blessing over this service and over our offering. In Jesus' name, amen. And the children can be dismissed for children's church. And we're going to sing My Jesus, I Love Thee, number 24 in the Brown Hymn.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, first of all, a joy to share. That is, Tim and Jen Fetzer had a daughter, Kendall and Taylor, born on Monday. So we rejoice with that new child in their lives. I was joking about one of the men the other week about he had surgery, so he couldn't lift over 10 pounds, but he was an usher carrying the offering plate. I jokingly said, I don't think you have to worry about carrying 10 pounds with that, do you? Now this morning there were two of them, because Bob Gibble was also, he had surgery a little less than 2 weeks ago. And so I don't think carrying the offering plates will hurt them much, but we're glad for God's grace on them and God's blessing. Now Linda Zimmerman is recovering from knee surgery. Continue to keep her in prayer as well. I didn't hear the results, and they might not have the results yet, but Nancy Miller was down at Fox Chase on Friday for testing to determine a future course of treatment for Nancy and her battle with cancer. Brenda Michu is having a lot of struggles with her lupus lately, besides some other issues that have come into her life and given her a real struggle. Remember her. My youngest sister, Lois, is in the hospital having suffered a stroke. You know, keeps hitting my family here lately for some reason. And my brother, Bill, has just been moved into a hospice facility where he's dealing with cancer. So there's a lot of issues, a lot of people that are struggling, and we want to lift them before the God's throne of grace. Let's pause for prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we pause to thank you. We love you because you first loved us. You've given your life for us on the cross of Calvary to redeem us, to give us hope, to give us encouragement and blessing day by day. And we have a hope for the future. Not necessarily in a future in this world, because our bodies are still subject to the human frailties and weaknesses. And many among us are struggling and suffering. We think of those that are facing the imminence of translation from this life into the next. We are reminded, Lord, of your word that reminds us to be apart from the body as we present with the Lord. We give you thanks. We pray for those that are recovering, for Bob and Bruce and Linda. We pray for your blessing upon each one of them. And Lord, we pray for those that are struggling with life-threatening illnesses, for Nancy and Brenda and Donna and Bill and Lois. Lord, we lift them before your throne of grace and pray that you would indeed give them hope and encouragement, that they would know the peace that comes in knowing and acknowledging Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, to realize that no matter what they may face in this life, in Jesus, we have a great and marvelous future. Your word reminds us that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed. We do rejoice with Tim and Kim in the birth of their daughter. And we pray your blessing upon that young family, that you will be a blessing to them and all the families in the church and all the children. Lord, the children are precious, and we enjoy them and we love them. We're reminded that even Jesus, when he was here upon earth, said, allow the little children to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of God. So we're thankful for all the children among us, Lord. Be a blessing to all the families in this church. Lord, we pray for the church. We're thankful, Lord, that a decision has been made for the future of this congregation. We pray for wisdom and discernment and guidance throughout the process and the transition that will come in a few months. Be a blessing both to the church and to the one who will come to be the minister, the pastor. Lord, we pray your blessing upon all, that your will may be done. We pray for the church, the wider church, the church of the brethren, the denomination. We pray the moving of your spirit in the lives of many and among the congregations. We pray, Lord, for the church around the world. We pray for the brothers and sisters in the Dominican Republic and for those that are going to minister there. Lord, I think of also the brothers and sisters in Haiti and several from the church at Midway are there ministering now. I pray for the people of Nigeria and the struggles that they're going through. May they know your grace to be sufficient. Will they stand firm in faith no matter what they may face in this world. There are people all around the world that daily are facing the imminence of a possibility of being martyred for their faith. May they stand strong and firm, knowing that in the end you have a place for them. May they stand and be counted among those who belong to Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for your blessing for the rest of this hour together, that your word may be written in our hearts. May we grow strong in our faith and our faithfulness, Lord, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. We give you praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I've chosen not to read the scripture at this point because I'll be dealing with all of the scripture in the time of my message. And so right now we'll consider the word that we have. We're coming to practical application in the book of Romans. It's where the gospel walks in shoe leather, where the leather hits the road, so to speak. How painful is it to be a Christian? Growing, maturing Christians will encounter some pain. In first place, we lose some of the superficial pleasures when we abandon sinful activities. And it will happen. I think I mentioned a woman that I ministered to. She had gone through cancer, and I shared the gospel with her, and she said, "I believe everything you say about Jesus, but I'm not ready to accept him as my Savior yet because there's things in life I want to do. But if I become a Christian, I don't think I'll be able to do them." People are like that, you know. I did tell her that whatever you give up of this world and of this life is going to be replaced by something far better in Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me tell you, I don't think you'll find anybody any happier than I. Yes, I'm engaged, but more than that, I'm praising God because Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Amen. I know I have a glorious future, and I want to live for him now in this world. I want to serve him. I want to continue to reach out to others that they also may experience the same thing. Becoming living sacrifices, that is, giving our lives totally to God, does not mean endless martyrdom, however. We can find fulfillment and satisfaction in becoming what God created us to be, no matter what the cost for us. We will see a higher purpose in life than simply avoiding pain. We talked a little bit about that in Sunday school. You come to Jesus, and some of them you see on TV, you come to Jesus and you go get a new job, a better paying job, a nicer house, a bigger car, and all those good things. No, that's not what it's talking about. But let me tell you, I don't need any of those things to have a joy in my heart because of Jesus. There must come a time in life when you say one big yes to the will of Jesus, the call upon your life. How can we know God's will? We discern God's will by honoring and obeying him and by refusing to be influenced by social pressures. As we replace our old way of thinking and adopt an entirely new perspective in this world from God's point of view, we'll begin to recognize God's will more and more. It's a matter of the commitment of your heart. And when you commit your heart and life to Jesus Christ, he will reveal that which is far better. We find it easier to heed his voice in a variety of situations. God may not dictate the very details of lives, such as what color of clothes we should wear today, or all those little things, he's not concerned about that. But he will give us spiritual principles for everyday decisions. Starting in our scripture now, first two verses of Romans chapter 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. God's will is perfect. He doesn't do anything halfway. If we yield our life to him, he won't do anything halfway. That doesn't say we won't go through the struggles of life because, as I already said just a little while ago in my prayer, our bodies are still subject to human frailties and weaknesses, and so we go through struggles in this life. But if you know Jesus Christ, I know from experience within my family, my loved ones, I know that God will carry us through no matter what. No matter what, we have joy ahead of us. We praise God for it. The word transform means a radical change. A radical change. I can tell you my life has changed. I'm not the same as I once was. And by God's grace, I will be far more than what I am right now. I've said this many times. I haven't come to the point where I've arrived and I know all there is. I'm still learning. I've described myself as a lifelong learner. And I want to seek God's will because it is a good and acceptable and perfect will. The world consists of people who think and act and plan and live apart from God. Okay? Glenn, there's your answer to your question in Sunday school class, right? People who live apart from God. The world says, wear these clothes, sing these songs, join these clubs, go to these places, eat, drink, and be merry. But God says, don't be conformed to it. Don't let this world squeeze you into its mold. The world will do that. Oh my, it sure will. The nonconformity spoken of is a broad principle. It applies to our actions, our words, our attitudes, and our whole manner of life. I've known plenty of people over the years that go to church on Sunday morning and they sing the hymns and listen to the sermon and then Monday morning, their speech is just like the world. Years ago, we were working on putting an addition on my brother-in-law, sister-in-law's house, and there's one fellow that he let the words fly. And he would say to me, whoops, I'm sorry. Then he said, maybe if I stand around you long enough, I might be able to get myself straightened out. But the reality is standing close to somebody isn't going to do it. It's a commitment of your heart. You need to have a transformation of life. All these fashions of the world. Now Satan knows if he can get us to conform to the world in the way we dress, then he can get a lot of other areas too. You'll also be in command of those many other areas of life and get us to conform to his will if he gets hold of us. So God says, don't pattern after the outward forms of this world system. Looking at Romans 12, 3 through 8. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment. In Sunday school, we were talking about humility. Humility. Each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, And the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. The one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. This is talking about the various gifts of the Spirit. It points out that we can serve the Lord effectively only when we come to realize that the church is the body of Christ made up of many individual members, and we all have some gift to be used by God in the world around us. We each have a different gift. But we all do have a gift. Every member of the human body has its own function. Even so, God gives each believer some particular gift to make him a direct benefit to the body of Christ. Now, the gifts are supernatural abilities, yes, above and beyond natural talent. In some cases, however, they may spring by spiritual empowerment of a person's natural abilities. In other words, God uses our lives. He uses what we have to his glory and honor if we will yield everything to him. And so we have these gifts that are mentioned in our scripture. There is a gift of prophecy, which is preaching or declaring the message of God. The Greek refers not so much to foretelling. Many times we think of prophecy as only foretelling the future. But the Greek word has a connotation of proclaiming the word. And in fact, it has more of that idea than it does in foretelling the future. Proclaiming the word, unfolding the message of God so that it becomes plain for those who hear. And there's the gift of ministry. This is the ability to serve. That refers to helping, especially with physical needs, setting up chairs, giving out songbooks in the worship service, and preparing for love feasts and all the things we do in church. You know, I already talked about humility, and I've seen at Midway especially, since I'm most associated, I've seen people there when they're setting up for whatever's going on in Family Life Center and cleaning up afterwards. I've seen a medical doctor, putting out chairs and tables and cleaning the tables. Right across the street, Dale Martin, he owns that big business there, but I've seen him pushing a broom to clean up, right? We all have something to do. We can do. And we need to be active at it. The gift of ministry. We often encounter somebody that's going through a struggle in life, and they need somebody to come alongside them to offer them encouragement. Sometimes to reach in a pocket and help them out. Whatever is necessary. Then there is the gift of teaching. That's the ability to explain the scriptures and make them clear and understandable. It's not too different from that gift of prophecy. And so that's part of it, though, but we all have different levels. If you read Ephesians chapter 4, it talks about the gifts that are given. There are some prophets and pastors and teachers and evangelists, many, many levels of telling forth the word of God. And then the gift of exhorting means to encourage and sometimes admonish, to speak words of counsel and wisdom. Galatians 6:1 says, if you find someone, a brother, falling into sin, you who are spiritual, come alongside of them to restore them in the spirit of meekness, being very careful lest you also be caught in the sin. And so when someone is falling away, the exhorters are the ones who go to them and encourage them to turn around and live for the Lord Jesus Christ. Make a difference. And then there's the gift of giving. God gives some men the honest ability to make money so that they may be able to supply relief to those in need. You know, there are so many great people. I heard somebody that went to the Laterno University, the founder of the Laterno University, at one time a college, it's now a university, Mr. Laterno. He became a wealthy, very wealthy man because he knew how to make money by building earth-moving equipment. He became a wealthy man, but he gave most of it away. He didn't keep it for himself. J.C. Penney, I understand J.C. Penney gave up to 90% of his money away. William Colgate, same way. He vowed that if God would bless him, he would use it for his glory. Now, all of us can have the gift of giving, though. What did Jesus say about the widow? Remember the story about the widow? Everybody was bringing their change, dropping it in the bucket, and she put two small coins in. Right away, Jesus, this woman has given more than all of the rest of you because she, out of her poverty, gave everything. You know the difference between Cain and Abel when they offered their gifts? We're told that Abel brought the first, the best, before God, while Cain, apparently from the description of it, Cain just brought what was kind of left over, something that he didn't really need for himself. See, that's the difference. It's strange, but the lower economic level of people give a far greater percentage to charity and the church than those who have great money, except for those like Colgate and Laterno and Penny and some of those. Many people with a lot of money really don't give a great percentage. I read one time about a man that when he was making $100 a week, I know some of you young people never imagined that. When I got out of high school, I was making $55 a week. But I heard about this man when he was making $100 a week, he gave $10 a week and he was fine. $200 he gave $20, $500 he gave $50. Then he started making $1,000 a week. He went to the pastor. He says, you know, it's really getting more difficult now because that means $100 out of $1,000. That's a lot to give. He wanted the pastor to pray for him. So the pastor did. He prayed that God would reduce his income so it wouldn't be so hard for him to give. So, then there's the gift of ruling. Ruling is the gift of administration. Every church needs administrators. Every church needs those who are good at leading the church in the administration. You know, we don't have some who are really good at administration. We wouldn't work very well together. Things would go bad very quickly. And so there's the gift of administration. The church needs those. The last gift name is the gift of showing mercy. The Greek word means sick visitor. Sick visitor. Not that he's sick. Sick hyphen visitor means that they are those who visit the sick. You remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25 when he talked about the last day and he was going to divide the sheep and the goats and those who were invited to the right, you fed me, you clothed me, you gave me water, you visited me in the hospital when I was in prison. When did we do that? Inasmuch as you did it unto the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. On the other hand, those who refuse to do any of that, and they were pushed to the side, well, when did we see you and didn't minister? If you didn't do it under the least of these, my brethren, you refused to do it to me. That's a gift that enables people to bring brightness and cheerfulness into the sick room. I have to admit that sometimes I'm blessed more than the person. Early in my ministry, I visited a woman that was very sick. She'd been sick most of her life. She'd been many years in hospitals, in and out, and she was confined to bed. She was the first one I visited when I entered the ministry. When I went to see her, she ministered to me more than I did to her, because her life, in spite of all the difficulties, her life was filled with joy and peace and hope. You walked into a room and you saw the glory of the Spirit of God there, and she ministered to me. Every believer should exercise the gift that God has given him. If God calls you to be a custodian of the church, you ought to be the best ever. If he's given you the gift of teaching, of making the scriptures clear and understandable, this ought to be your greatest business. I once heard about a young fellow going to a seminary. Apparently it was a small seminary, but he was in seminary. And he went into the restroom, and he thought it was disgusting and dirty, and he went to the president of a seminary to complain about how bad the restroom was. The next day, the young man went into the restroom, and the president was cleaning the restroom. You know, when we see things like that, instead of complaining, we might just jump in and do it, right? That's what we ought to be doing. No one has all the gifts, but each one has one gift. Never think that you can't do anything. On the other hand, never think that you can do everything. Sometimes we get overwhelmed because we take on too much and we try to do everything and we become overwhelmed. And that's when we suffer what is called burnout. If you get too involved in everything, you will suffer burnout. But find that area that your gift is and give yourself to it. Our relationship toward other Christians can be described with the word love. Let's look at verses 9 through 13. Let love be genuine, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with brotherly affection, outdo one another in showing honor, do not be slothful in zeal, be fervent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, be constant in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, and seek to show hospitality. Oh, that's a loaded portion, isn't it? We should recognize that we're described by the word love. Genuine love is affectionate, verse 10. The world is accustomed to harsh dealings among men. They take advantage, deceive with lying words, lose their tempers, but the Christian possesses a love that is open-hearted and kind and thoughtful. Real love is enthusiastic. Verse 11 says, not lagging and diligent or fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, or not slack. Our work in a church should be characterized by zeal and energy and joy and fervency. We must never just drag along. Oh, well, the board's meeting Tuesday night. I guess I have to go. I mean, that happens a lot. I mean, I have to admit, sometimes it is kind of hard to drag yourself out, but if you call to do it with zeal. Genuine love is hopeful. Verse 12, Christians are happy because of their hope. No one tells of his visit with a native, somebody tells of his visit with a native preacher in Nigeria. The preacher had a brother who was unconverted tribal chief, a cruel and hard man. The difference between these two brothers as they were observed talking together was evident in many ways. The eyes of the tribal chief showed great cruelty. His features were hard and pitiless. The preacher showed a countenance that showed kindness and calmness and love. But that kindly native preacher was once a man of cruelty, just like his brother. But now the preacher had become a child of hope, and even his countenance showed the difference. Genuine love is helpful, verse 13. A Christian shares his resources with those in need. Without hospitality, the early church could not have existed very well. Christians traveled from place to place. Sometimes they were traveling evangelists, as Paul was. Sometimes they traveled to escape persecution. There were no hotels. There were inns, but the inns were expensive and centers of evil practices. And so the doors of the Christian homes were open to traveling believers. Every Christian home should be an inn where traveling Christians would be welcome. Verses 14 through 21. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That's quite a mouthful too, isn't it? Genuine love is forgiving. The real test of our faith is our attitude toward those who misuse us. Paul says we should pray for God's blessings on our enemies, our persecutors, even as Jesus did on a cross. Remember what Jesus said on the cross after hanging there for several hours? He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Reality is that those who persecute, those who hurt, in a sense, really don't know what they're doing. They don't have the heart of Jesus, and so we should pray for them. Jesus looked on the bloody hands of those who mocked him and said, Father, forgive them. Real love is sympathetic. Verse 15 says, rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that weep. We should share the joys with everyone that they're going through, and should also be sharing in their struggles when they are sad. When you hear the health and happiness or prosperity of a Christian brother, rejoice with them. But don't envy his success. And when brethren and sisters are passing through the valley of weeping and the struggles, we should weep with them. Come alongside them with an arm around their shoulder. The Christian can expect to have enemies. If you are following Jesus Christ very carefully, you are going to have enemies. You're going to have people. Where you work, there'll be some who will put you down because you are a person of faith. You don't get involved in the same things they're involved. So they're going to be your enemies. We can expect to have enemies. So the final portion of this chapter instructs us about how we should treat those who mistreat us. First, we must avoid retaliation. Verse 17 says, repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for the good things in the sight of all men. When someone does evil against us, we must not retaliate. We're not to do to others as they do to us. And yet, how many times you hear it? I'll get even with them someday. Maybe not. I'll get even with them. They haven't heard a last from me. You ever hear anybody like that? I've heard plenty of them over the years. But we are not to retaliate. Try to preserve peace. Verse 18 says, if it be possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. We should seek every means possible to maintain harmony with others. The other party may not yield. They may not come around right away, but if we are God's people and we seek to live in peace with them, what does that scripture says? Feed them, clothe them, give them something. You'll be heaping coals of fire on the head. Now, the coals of fire that is speaking here is not literal hot coals being poured on the head. But what it is implying here is that when you respond with kindness and love, you're going to heap a lot of remorse on them, hopefully so that they will come to see what they need in their lives. They will come to see that they need Jesus Christ. Do not take revenge, but rather give place to wrath in the King James, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No revenge. When someone harms us, the natural reaction is to take things in our own hands, to try to get even. That's not the way it is. Verse 20 says that the way to move a man's heart is to treat him with kindness. Kindness makes a deep impression on the enemy. If they do something to us and we just simply turn around, embrace them, love them, reach out to them, you're going to touch their heart and lives some way, sometime. It may not be right away. It'll bring a sense of shame to them when they have treated you as they did. Maybe not all will turn to repentance, but if you do that and if you practice that, you will touch many lives. The Bible never endorses personal revenge or manipulation of others. To love our enemies means that ultimately we will do absolutely the best for them. Now, to live this kind of life that Paul is talking about here, to live the kind of life described requires a supernatural birth. The greatest thing we can do today is to give our hearts in surrender to Jesus Christ and allow him to impart unto us a new and different nature. Open your heart to Jesus. He will give you power to live a new kind of life. There'll be a spring in your step, right? And a joy in your heart, and a peace in your soul that you have never experienced before until you come to Jesus. The invitation is always open for anyone who would like to come and accept Jesus, to offer their lives and confession to Jesus Christ and allow him to transform their lives. Would you pray with me? Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your grace, for your love, for redeeming us, for giving us hope in Jesus Christ, and realize that in Jesus all things are possible. In ourselves, in our own strength, we're going to falter. We're going to fail. We're going to fall on our faces. But Lord, when we are living for you and with you, your Holy Spirit will give us everything we need to live for you and to show others the way to eternal life. And so bless us and use us each one, Lord, that we may bring glory and honor to you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. There's victory in Jesus. Amen. And we're about to sing about that. Victory in Jesus. Would you stand as we sing?
I heard all the glory, I say.
Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace now and evermore. Amen. And all God's people said it.